Hallelujah. Amen. Glory to Jesus. God bless you all. It is a glorious thing to have you online with me this evening. God bless you. And this is the first edition of Family Matters to God be the glory. This is what God has commissioned us to do at this time, point in time. And what does it entail when we talk about family matters? It has to do with things that has to do with our marriages, our homes, our children, our finances, most especially as Christian parents. We agree with me today, a lot is going on in our society, and we take the glory of God to rectify most of these things. And that is why such a program has come. And please, in case you have been having knowledge about this, this is an opportunity to learn more. Praise the Lord. And to God be the glory, we are going to be handling the first edition today. And what do we have to discuss on ground today? It has to do with how to raise up godly kids. I repeat myself, how to raise up godly kids, most especially as Christian parents. Amen. You have kids already. God bless you. This is a time to learn more. And in case you have not gotten one, you even stand a better chance to gather knowledge. Knowledge is never wasted, especially the essential ones. I remember the great Archbishop Benson in the house of great, memories. To God be the glory for his life. If this says something, he said, when you stop learning, you stop dying. And I want to believe somebody is alive this evening. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And also, we thank God for what he's doing in our midst. This evening, I'm not going to be handling the matter alone. And have right here in the studio with me a great man of God I have known for years. When I mean years, for two decades now, that's over 20 years. We have known, and he's a man of great reputation, and he fears God. For me to have invited him for this very first edition of this Family Matter, that's going to tell you how much I have how much I hold him in great esteem, this man of God. So please permit me to welcome online tonight with us. And we're going to be discussing this matter on how to raise godly kids together. This great man of God, Pastor Muyiwa Oderinde, all the way from the Hour of Light Ministry here in Como, Milan, Italy. God bless you, sir.
God bless you. Thank you very much for the invitation. God bless you, viewers. God bless you. We trust God is going to be a wonderful encounter, a wonderful time together this evening in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you very much.
Amen. 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 Thank you, sir. Thank you for your warm greetings. God bless you. Nice having you around. Amen. God bless you, sir. Amen. So, sir, concerning what is on ground, as I said earlier on, for the hearing of our viewers, that we're going to be handling the topic by the grace of God, how to handle godly kids. And I, for one, I known you that you have kids, I think four for that matter, and they have grown. They've grown. I think someone should be 17 or 18, if I'm not mistaken, sir.
He's 18 now, his son that is
18. Okay, 18. You see, for a man of God to have a child 18 years, that goes to tell us he has a lot of experience and also vast in the word of God to help us in this time. So you just sit back and relax, believing God will bless us tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to be looking at a few questions this evening. And number one, I have here written as that one. Sir, how do you think we can actually raise up godly kids, most especially in this generation we are in? We can raise up kids that still fear God. What are the points you can give us to encourage us, sir?
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Let me start by saying that the issue of raising godly children is very, very important.
Mm-hmm.
And it is not something that can be overemphasized.
Yes.
In the book of Proverbs chapter 22 and verse 6, the Bible tells us that teach up a child in the way that it should go.
Mm-hmm.
And when it grows up, it will not depart from it.
Exactly, sir.
To raise godly children, I think the first thing we need to do is to be an example to our children.
That's right, sir.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
If you as a parent, because sociologists or educational psychologists, they told us that you impart more knowledge when you show that thing you are teaching by example than when you say it with words of mouth. Children are very, very sensitive. They pick everything you are doing. They watch you. They watch everything you are doing. So if as a parent, you are not doing something and you are telling your children to do it, is going to result into a waste of time and energy. So first thing first, if you want to bring up these children in a godly way, you yourself must start living a godly life. Because you are the first example they see.
Exactly, yes.
Praise
yes.
the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Now, after we have been able to establish that, then we need to be feeding them with the word of God.
Okay.
That's why the Bible says we should teach them the way that they should go. I've always told people that of all the education you can give to children, the most important education is spiritual education.
Mm.
And what is spiritual education? Make them know the ways of God. Make them know the God that you are serving. Once they know that one, every other thing will fall in place. It's when you invest so much on education, it is good to give them quality education.
While
you are striving to give them quality academic education, make sure you give them quality spiritual education. That will solve a lot of problems. Because the Bible told us in the book of Isaiah, he said, I will remember the chapter now. He said, our children shall be taught of the Lord.
Yes, yes.
And great shall be their peace. If you teach them the ways of God, when they are alone, because you can't be with them always. When you look at the story of Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, the Bible called them boys.
Yes.
They were not up to 20.
Mm.
It was what they learned
from their parents
that they went to practice
in Babylon. Yes. In a strange land. Yes, that's
so true. The most important thing is, number one, be an example to them. Don't do like some of our parents did then. They will tell us to follow mommy to church and daddy will be at home discussing with his friend or reading newspaper. That boy will say, one day I will grow up like daddy and I will not go to church like not going to church. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So you must be an example to them.
Mm.
Once you are the example, then you make them know the way of God, feed them with the word of God. You'll be able to raise godly children. Praise the Lord.
Amen. Those were powerful points. In fact, I was blessed. You know, you have said quite a lot, sir. You know, looking at back what you have said, I want to pick from what you have said, sir. You know, you did mention that raising up godly kids, apart from showing them an example, the area you mentioned that also we need to teach them about the word of God. Also, you know, concerning what is happening in our society today, you know, we live in a society whereby parents are so much busy because we want to meet up with what is on grand schedule, most especially maybe the financial aspect. Especially, I don't know about Nigeria now, because when I was growing up in Nigeria, I knew that our parents, especially our fathers, they might not be at home all day long. But our mothers, you know, they have some time they spend with the kids.
Yeah.
And you see, we grew up, you know, with the fear of God and all this. But then, you know, the society is a different thing entirely now. Especially we in the developed world, like for example in America and in Europe, you see a mother and a father walking around the clock, all because they want to meet up, maybe the financial, you know, burden of the family and others. And you find that these children, they are left to themselves. So, sir, what do you think we can help in this present situation?
Praise the Lord. Thank you for the question, man. You see, one thing we need to know is this. Getting married, or let me say having children, is a big responsibility.
Exactly, sir.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And any big responsibility that you want to excel in it, you must be ready to put in sacrifice. Once you are able to sacrifice, then that responsibility will become a reality. Now, what am I trying to say? We live in a world where everybody, there is this drive towards materialism.
Too much these days.
Like you said earlier, in our own days, most of us, our fathers are working. Our mom is too. But you discover that when daddy is working, he goes in the morning, comes back in the night. Mommy is there as a civil servant. Maybe it's a teacher. Maybe a civil servant. She's at home with you by 3:30 before daddy will come in the evening. So that parental presence was always there. But now, if you live in the world that we live in now, when you have a situation that somebody goes in the morning, come in the night, the other person going, who takes care of the children? So my own suggestion, my own idea is, what I practiced, is in the formative age of the children, when they are still very young, there has to be a trade-off, a balance. If the husband, who is the head of the home, who is supposed to provide for the home, is doing morning to evening, work 8 hours, 9 hours, and is not going to be around, let the woman of the house take up a job that is not going to take much of her time, maybe a part-time job,
so that
she can have time for the children.
For the children.
Because the thing is this, the job will always be there. Don't let us deceive ourselves. okay, maybe we want to build houses in Nigeria or want to do other things. Those things can always be done.
Yes, countless.
But you see, the years the children miss with you, you can never recover it.
That's true,
it can never be recovered.
Yes.
So me, I'm always of the opinion that that's what I did anyway. In the formative year, there was a time my wife was not even working because, you know, I had the children one after
the other. Yes, I still remember.
So she was always at home with them. But by the time they started to grow and they have little independence, you understand? Hey, then she took up something on a part-time basis. And gradually, by the time you have two or three of them that are on their own now, you cannot do something on a full-time basis.
You see?
Because, you see, the issue is what our mothers did was that they did not value their career
more than the family. Yes.
And
yes.
If you look at it, most of them, at the end of the day, they still achieve that career.
Exactly. And it's even more better than what is happening.
The career, they still pursued it, but they were pursuing it. Maybe a program that would have taken them 2 years if they didn't have children. It took them four years.
And they still achieved it.
And they still achieved it.
And those kids, they raised them up so well. And like you and I, we are good examples of the great work they did.
Praise the Lord. So that's my own opinion.
You are very correct, sir. So please, viewers, I want to believe you are learning something greatly, especially you that have kids or planning to raise a family. Please, this is very, very essential. A lot and a lot is happening among our kids today. Come to think of it, look at the armed robbers on the street today or the kidnappers. These were children that were given birth to by parents. I know some of them might have been raised up well, but nonetheless, let's face the fact, some of them, they missed it. When a child is not being corrected on time, and that child raised up, grow up to become something else. And it is, and I remember a saying I learned years ago, that, you know, it is easier to raise a child than to raise an adult. It is, you know, it's very difficult to raise a character that's been inbuilt over years. So come and remove that character from that person. It's very, very difficult. God will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
God bless you, sir. So please, you are handling a job or money to get a job, especially a mom, please sit down. Please, and we're being women. I am a woman, to God be the glory, and you're having children. Let's not do it as if we're having competition with our husbands. No, we're in a world today. I've come to learn my husband is building a mansion. I too must build a mansion. If I don't build a mansion, I must build something close to my husband. Who says so? And by the time we have this mindset, this notion on our head, we abandon our major responsibility to these children. We know that God has said the parents, that is a husband and wife, to raise their children together. But the truth still remains, most of the time, we the women will have the opportunity to spend more time, especially at the formative age of these children, when they are so very young, to spend much more time with them than their fathers. So please, mom online, please, I am pleading, let's spend some time with these children. It's very, very important. And you will enjoy it tomorrow. I bet you will enjoy it. Because whatsoever I must wear, that shall live. God bless you. Amen. To save time, let's take a look at the next question. To God be the glory this evening. We want to see that. Well, okay. Sir, as I said earlier on, I have known you for years now, and over 20 years. And I know that you have kids for a time. This question is that, sir, are all your children same in characters?
No, they have different characters.
They have different characters. That's to say, at least one of them have four different characters. Okay. So if they differ in character, how do you think we can raise them without creating jealousy in their house? I don't know if you understand me.
I understand you very well. Okay, praise the Lord. It requires the wisdom of God. But
yes, sir,
we need to understand something. In the book of Jeremiah chapter 1 and verse 5, God told Jeremiah that before I formed thee in the belly, I knew you.
Yes.
And before you came out, I sanctified thee and ordained thee a prophet to the nations. Now, every child that comes into this world has a unique purpose.
Exactly.
And the way God does these things, our God is a God of purpose, a God of planning. God, if you are looking for the master planner, nobody qualifies for that title except the Almighty God. So the kind of assignment or the kind of thing that child is going to do in life, at times, most of the time, you will see it is demonstrated in the character.
Yes, from the, when they are so very, very young. Yes.
You see it in their character. Mm. So if you have maybe a child that maybe God is grooming to, like, I have a friend, he's elderly, more older than me. I've known him to be a Christian since the 90s. He has a son who is a military man in one of the countries in Europe today. Now, a child that is going to join the military, the kind of temperament he's going to have
We differ.
We differ from one that is going to be a medical doctor.
That's true.
No, there might not be any logical explanation for it. But we need to understand the uniqueness of each child. They pick, okay, maybe my kind of person, I'm the type that talks very well, my wife does not talk. Out of your four children.
Yes.
You might be lucky some of them will be talking, some will not be talking. Quiet. And if you are lucky, all of them might be quiet. And if it's the other way, all of them might be talking. So you need to understand that each of them, they have different characters. And you know one thing we should always know as this is parents. The Bible says children are the heritage of the Lord. They are blessings from the Lord. And the fruit of the womb is his reward. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Now, we are not the owners of these children. It is God that gave them to us. We are caretakers. So as a caretaker, you must manage them properly. If you have a child that you know, okay, this kind of person, okay, when we were growing up, let me give you an example, the family I came from. When we are growing up, maybe I'm the kind of person that likes to keep money, plan money. I have another brother, and that one money comes, he spends it. That is his own character. So as a parent, you must know how to balance it. And how you can do it most is don't compare these children with themselves.
Exactly. That's where we make mistakes, most parents.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
You see, the mistakes some parents made in those days, can't you see? Yeah. Are you not, is this one not your brother? Why is he doing like this? You are not doing like this.
Already, when you say that, or not to you as a parent, seed has been sown.
You are already sowing a seed of discord in those children. Love them equally. If you have to correct them, correct them in love, not making reference to what the other person is doing.
Better.
Because one thing we need to understand is that some children are early starters. Some are late starters.
That's true. Yes, yes.
Recently, with the advent of social media, some of my friends that went to secondary school together, we have opportunity to meet online and everything. I know there were some guys in school that maybe they have to write WAEC twice before they made
some
their papers.
More than that.
Before they made their papers and proceeded to
do that.
But I'm telling you, some of them are professors today.
You see
life. And the ones that were there, that were even
they are still struggling. They are not
that they are not doing fine. They are doing fine in their own way. But when you look at the two people, the set that was a early starter, everybody is doing well at their own level. You cannot push one aside in the society. You cannot push the other aside in the society. So we need to understand that everybody have their own timing. Some children will pick the thing immediately. Some it takes some
time.
So it is not a question of it is how well that matters, not how soon.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
You started. That was a great one indeed. Amen. So please, viewers, you have children. Please, this goes to tell us, let's be careful. If care is not taken, we can create discord in our home family unknown to us. And to correct it, it is not an easy job. So please be well. God bless you. Amen. So let's quickly look at what we have on as the next question again. Is that, raising up children, sir.
Yes, sir.
Concerning them more, now what I've come to learn is that from the age of 18, a child is referred to as an adult.
In the Western world.
Yes. But is it actually true? Because when I said that, not I'm doubting the medical, conclusion at that age. Because when they say child is an adult, concerning the biological, it's matured, probably to, function biological and stuff. But I've come to discover that at that 18, some children are not yet still matured. They need to be cautious. Whereas, just as you said, the level of maturity differs from every child. So, because they said 18 is the age whereby a child comes to maturity, so should every child be referred to as that? That because you are 18, you see a parent, because a child is 18, just push him or her, left on his or her own. Is it the right thing to do as a parent?
No. My own opinion is this. Even in the Bible, once you are 20, the Bible recognizes you as an adult. If you look at the book of Numbers chapter 14, when God was bringing judgment on the children of Israel because of the fact that they said they wanted to go back to Egypt when the spies brought the report, God now told Moses that everybody from the age of 20 and above, they will not make it to the promised land. In other words, God expects that even at age 20, you should be able to take responsibility for your own life. Now, the question you have asked, my own answer is this. Now, You see, when we are having children, there are I've once had a woman of God say it, that there are different stages with us in the life of our children. You understand? When you give birth to them, there is a time you control them. Do this, you must do it. But gradually, when they are growing, the relationship changes
with time.
With time, you now get to the level where you become their friend and their advisor.
Yes, that's true.
Because legally speaking, in for example, in Italy where we are now, by the time a child is 18, he doesn't need the permission of the parents or anything
again. Yes,
and not only in Italy. There are places a man of God once went to one of these Scandinavian countries to preach, and when he was talking, he said, if you come to Jesus, he can bless you, he can give you a house, give you a job and everything. So one young guy just stood up in the congregation and said, excuse me, sir, if that is the only thing your Jesus can do, I don't think I need him.
I have everything already.
Is that because in this country, once you are 18, the government gives you a council flat, they give you enough loan to buy a car, they give you a job. So the man now said, okay, he can heal you. He can give you an anointing to say, okay, if he die one, let's talk about that one. What am I trying to say? By the time they are 18, they are free to do whatever they want to do.
Yes.
And if you become too harsh, they will just tell you, ciao, papa. Arrivederci. We'll see later. They might even rent an apartment and they won't even tell you where they are staying. And if you push too much, where we are, they can call police for you that this person is disturbing me. He's my father, but I want my privacy. Are you able? So it is the level you now enter, the level of friendship with them.
Yes.
And counselor. Okay, I know you are 18, but you see, even at 18, the law says you are 18. I'm not doubting that. But this thing you want to do, let me now tell you from experience. Why not do it this way? You are now counseling. When you begin to do that, they will be able to trust you. But when you become too harsh, and that is one of the issues we have, we African parents, maybe by reason of the time we are brought up. I know parents, when we are growing up, even a child of 25, they can still deal with him anyhow. You can't do that here now. So you now become a friend. You begin to counsel. They want their freedom. You give them that freedom. You don't show yourself as if you are imposing anything on them. You are regulating. But you now become a friend that they can tell, okay, this is what I want to do. Once they tell you and you're able to tell them, oh, this that you want to do, let me tell you something. This that you want to do, do it this way. By the time you give them the counsel the first time, the second time, and they discover that, the last time I wanted to do something and my dad or my mom told me to do it another way, I did it and I got a result better than what I expected. You now become their friend. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Because when you look at it, whether we like it or not, a child will always be a child in the hands of the father. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
A child will always be a child in the hands of the parents. But then, at that level, when the Lord says they are majority, like they say, they are adults, give them that. Operate with them at that level of understanding. You now become a friend. It's not, yo, you must do this. Because if the condition becomes too tough for them, hey, you know where we are now. He can walk up to the bank and take up a loan himself, even without your consent. And he will begin to live his life without. That time, you'll not be able to do anything. So now you now become parties. You become friends. That's my own opinion. Praise the Lord.
Amen. Thank you very much, sir.
God
bless you, sir. Amen. It has been a great day, viewers. God bless you for making yourself available. The Lord will really bless you. Amen. And before we leave, I want to say a big thank you, sir.
We thank
Pastor Muyiwa, for making yourself available.
We give glory to
God. In fact, we have learned so much tonight. And I believe that which we have learned, we'll be able to practice it. It will come across your way. Remain blessed. Amen. Bye.